So now we're going to talk about surgical therapies. Full disclosure, I'm a surgeon, so I know probably more about this than anything else, although I do plenty of other therapies. I treat lots of people, though. I don't think just because you have gastroparesis, you need surgery, and most people don't. We already talked about diets and medications, and lots of people are going to be better, or even waiting and doing nothing. Some people will come to surgery. It's a smaller percentage, and we're going to go in the order of history rather than frequency, just to give you a better sense of how things have evolved over time. The first surgical therapy we're going to talk about is gastric electrical stimulation. This is probably better known as the gastric pacemaker. The trade name is Entera, E-N-T-E-R-R-A. It's a device. It was introduced and approved in this country around 2001. I was in one of the initial training classes from Medtronic, the company that makes it. And it's a modified pacemaker. And initially what was thought was we were going to take a modified pacemaker, take some wires, just like we take wires from a pacemaker, put them in the heart, put them on the stomach, turn this thing on, and then the stomach is going to start pumping the food out. And what we know for sure is it doesn't work like that, that this is truly neural stimulation. It comes back to sort of what's the problem in gastroparesis or in some forms of gastroparesis. And the problem is the nerves are damaged. And so what do the nerves do in the stomach? Well, autonomic nerves or nerves that go to the intestine are not like our skeletal muscle nerves. Our skeletal muscle nerves, the ones that move our arms and our hands, when the nerve fires, the electrical impulse causes the muscle to contract, and it's the exact opposite in the intestine. When the nerves fire, it causes the muscle to relax. And so you can imagine that in the stomach, if the nerves are injured, then the muscle is not relaxing at the right time. And maybe it even spasms when the patient eats. So, and that's why sometimes we see patients who smell food and all of a sudden become very nauseated and have retching, or they eat like one bite and all of a sudden they're vomiting like crazy. It's not like they had a giant meal and they're vomiting. It can be literally one bite. And so this denervation effect can be very prominent. And the stimulator re-innervates. It gives electrical stimulation to the stomach. And there's certainly a subgroup of people who think that it increases accommodation. That is, it helps the stomach relax when the food comes down. This is borne out by some of the evidence in which, you know, the majority of patients who have a stimulator, their stomach doesn't empty better. If we measure gastric emptying before and we measure gastric emptying after, it's actually the same. There's a minority that will have improved emptying, but the majority do not. And yet the vast majority of people who get a stimulator, 75%, will experience significant improvement in their symptoms. And so we think about the problem as denervation, then gastric stimulation seems to make a lot more sense. Like I said, about 75% of people are going to improve. This therapy is much more effective in diabetics than it is in idiopathic patients. My experience is about 80% of diabetics are going to have improvement, and about 50% of folks who are idiopathic gastroparetics are going to have an improvement. Not that it can't work, but it's not as effective. And so for gastric stimulation, that's my first line therapy for the patient who has a diabetic gastroparesis, especially the ones that sort of have symptoms that sound like denervation, gastric spasm. And so those people generally would do pretty well with a gastric stimulator. And so we'll offer that as first line therapy, and then we'll progress through therapies if they need something else. Now, the gastric stimulator is a device, right? So it's a battery pack, and it's wires that go through the abdominal wall into the stomach. The battery has a lifetime, just like any battery, a battery in your car or your cell phone. That battery has to be replaced, depending on the settings, between 5 and 8 years after it's placed. And so, you know, you're talking about putting a gastric stimulator in a patient who's, you know, 40 years old. They're potentially looking at multiple replacements of the device. It's one of the reasons now we will commonly use adjunctive therapy or adjunctive surgery with the stimulator, and we'll talk about pyeloplasty in a minute. So most people will now do a pyeloplasty at the same time as the stimulator, trying to get as much effect as possible and maybe decreasing the frequency with which the stimulator needs to be changed. Very few complications with a stimulator. Your provider can give you a lot more detail on this, but it's generally a safe operation done with the video laparoscope. I keep people overnight, but some people will send them home the same day, and that's fine. The next therapy we're going to talk about is laparoscopic pyeloplasty, and this is a relatively new procedure. If you go to our site, there's another little slideshow you can read through that has a lot more information on pyeloplasty with some references, and I encourage that if you want to learn more. This is a procedure that's been around for about 3 years now, commonly, maybe a little bit longer. And based on some information out of the University of Oregon, was really the first group to publish on this, where they just took a bunch of people who had gastroparesis, and laparoscopically they cut the muscle at the end of the stomach. Now, if you think about the Botox data a little bit, you would think it probably wouldn't work that frequently. If Botox is working great, 20% of people respond, then we should expect 20% of people who have the muscle physically cut with surgery should also respond. And I think everybody in the group of people I know are really impressed that it works much more frequently than that. The published data is like 75 to 80% improvement in symptoms and improvement in gastric emptying. So remember, with the stimulator, there was no improvement in gastric emptying. With pyeloplasty, improvement in gastric emptying as well. And so for those folks that have like bad reflux from retained gastric secretions, this is like a better procedure for them. And so I started doing this procedure several years ago. I use it routinely in the idiopathics because those people seem to do better. There's been additional information over the last couple of years on looking at pylorus and pyloric function in patients with idiopathic gastroparesis. And turns out, not surprisingly, that the muscles in the patients who have idiopathic gastroparesis tend to be higher pressure. They're squeezing harder and they're hypertrophic. They're thicker than they're supposed to be. And this may be part of the etiology or the cause of idiopathic gastroparesis. So you eliminate that, you cut that muscle, that spasm or that high pressure that is eliminated, and patients feel much better. And so my experience has been similar to that of the medical literature. Many, many people improved quite dramatically. It's a laparoscopic operation. It's an overnight hospital stay in my hands. It's cutting the intestine, so there's a little bit of risk, bleeding, infections, rare incidents of leakage, but it's no implant. So there's no adjustments afterwards. There's no batteries to be changed. And so it has that benefit. So it's a nice little procedure. It works really well for people. There's few side effects. And so we like doing this. And again, I think the consensus opinion now is that even for diabetics who are going to have a stimulator, we add pyeloplasty to that to get the added benefit of increased emptying and see that result. Those two therapies work great together. You can do them sequenced, you can do them together. And then they seem to really improve people's life and get them back onto eating normal foods. Again, the destination for all these therapies is eating normal foods. Now, does that mean chicken wings every night? Doesn't mean chicken wings every night, right? It means maybe chicken wings. What it does mean is that you can eat solid food with your family and not be ostracized to some sort of minuscule diet or boring liquid diets or things that really take away from the quality of life, right? I mean, we live so much of our life around the table, so many of our meaningful events in life are around eating that, you know, it's our obligation to try to help people get to a point where they can eat normally. And so these procedures really provide that. And so these are good therapies. Now, not every single person is going to get better and with those two therapies. And in my experience, it's really the very severe diabetics who don't have a hypertensive stomach any longer. They have a completely flaccid stomach. There's no emptying at all. We'll sometimes see on the gastric emptying study what's called an ascending curve. They don't see it empty at all over the course of 4 hours. Sometimes even cutting the muscle or putting a stimulator is not going to help those people. And they can benefit from having their stomach removed. And the stomach is removed you know, an operation that looks similar to a gastric bypass, where we create a very small pouch at the top of the stomach, bring intestine up. So if you look at the diagrams that you'll see on your screen, the food is coming down the food tube into the small pouch and directly into the intestine. It never enters the stomach, and that stomach is then removed so that it can't cause any of the symptoms the patient has. This has also been studied more aggressively now that we're seeing more patients for gastroparesis therapy, and it can work very well. Is this a first-line therapy for most people? I don't think so. I think most people are going to get better without it. This is really a therapy as an end stage, highly effective, but there's some management involved. Those patients who require this therapy will behave very similar to weight loss surgery patients. And generally speaking, somebody who gets this therapy, they don't need to lose weight, right? That's not the problem. The problem is that they can't keep their weight on. And so we have to work pretty intensely with those folks. And they're diabetic, so they're going to see a dramatic alteration in their insulin metabolism. They're not going to be hungry, so we really got to help them. If the patient has a jejunostomy tube already, we'll keep it to help them through the adjustment period. But you know, people are getting admitted every month to the hospital for severe symptoms. You know, we can make that better. And this is a good therapy for that in the right patient. And so it's a big therapy, though. And I don't think the patient comes to the office the first time and we sit down and say, hey, you need to have your stomach out, right? It's a process. And it's getting to know one another, understanding what the disease is, trying some therapies. And if somebody gets that, it's great. And it works well. But in my opinion, not a first-line therapy. So a final therapy that's surgical that we offer for gastroparesis is actually gastric bypass, which you are probably more familiar with in terms of weight loss. Paradoxically, we will see some patients with very severe gastroparesis, lots of nausea and vomiting, who are significantly overweight. And while sometimes people can't understand how that can happen, remember, gastroparetics, when they're able to eat foods, it's typically high calorie liquids and low fiber foods. Those tend to have a lot of added sugar, lots of carbohydrates, and for some people's metabolism, that will lead to obesity very, very quickly. And so we'll see a subpopulation who are obese or morbidly obese with a body mass index over 35 who need therapy for gastroparesis. And in that group, we'll offer them gastric bypass. And that's, you can see on your screen, the picture of that. It looks very similar to the subtotal gastrectomy, except that we leave the stomach part in. This is well studied. It works very well. It leads to weight loss, which is much healthier for the patient. For the diabetics, it frequently leads to remission of their diabetes, their high blood pressure, their sleep apnea, and a resolution to the nausea so that, again, they're able to eat more normal foods, healthier, high-quality foods, higher in protein, some raw vegetables. And so we use that therapy in this group, and it seems to work well. It's a minority population, but still important to mention.